say, great mathematicians of the world. You know, I looked at his Wikipedia page just to see if I missed anything, and you know, I'd be all day reading the awards he's gotten, but let me at least mention the Fields Medal and the Breakthrough Prize, but many, many other things. I think the other thing I wanted to note is that I could easily invite him to every year's PCMI because he's done deep work in the subject. So. So, next year, Terry, we expect you back, okay? Anyway, very pleased to introduce Terry Tao from UCLA to speak on the cost of business life.
Okay, thanks, Matthew. So, this is a talk that has nothing to do with my research interests, unless you count my amateur astronomy interests as a kid. I've always liked astronomy. My parents bought me a telescope, and I loved finding all these facts and figures about stars and planets. And it was only a lot later that I realized all the mathematics behind it all, which I want to share some of it with you. So my talk is in a subfield of astronomy called astrometry. So astrometry is the study of positions of and sizes and so forth of celestial bodies. So all the things in the sky, sun, the moon, the planets, so forth. Just where they are, how far away they are, and so forth. So the type of questions we care about here are things like, you know, how far is it from the Earth to the Moon? How far is it from the Earth to the Sun? From the Sun to, you know, Venus? From the Sun to Alpha Centauri? To the Andromeda Galaxy, and so forth. What, you know, all these numbers. So, of course, nowadays it's very easy to figure these things out. You just look up Wikipedia, and they're all there. But where do these numbers come from? So I mean they're just way too far for any direct measurement to work. You can't just take a ruler or anything and just sort of measure any of these distances. There's no direct measurement for virtually any of these distances. But the way astronomers have, over thousands of years, astronomers have found many clever ways to measure distances indirectly. So for example, you know, here's a galaxy here. And you may not be able to directly measure the distance to this galaxy or to this galaxy, but we have ways of comparing the two and finding out the ratio, say, between this distance and this distance. So once you know one of them, these distances, you can then work out the other one. And they're very clever, and they often rely on both on mathematics and on technology, but to a large extent just on mathematics. So, for example, for very far galaxies, what you use is Hubble's law. That the distance for very distant objects is proportional to the recessional velocity, which you can measure by other means, and then you can compare the recessional velocities of these two galaxies, and then that gives you the ratio of these two distances here. So what that does for you is that it lets you control distances to very, very far away objects by distances to slightly less far away objects, which you then control in terms of distances to slightly less far away objects, and so on and so forth. And there are different techniques that work at different ranges. And fortunately, there's enough techniques to cover all the ranges we care about. But that's not a trivial thing at all. And so you have this hierarchy of distance measurements, which let you get from really far objects all the way down to scales, finally down to scales that you can actually measure directly. And that gives you distances all the way from Earth to the rest of the universe. And that's called the cosmic distance ladder. And here are just some runs of the ladder. We'll talk about many of these later in this talk. So what I'm going to do in this talk is just basically climb this ladder. Okay? So you start at the Earth and you just keep going up and up to higher and higher distance scales, and then each scale requires a different new idea to get further. But you know, over thousands of years we've actually done this. So the very first scale is just the Earth itself. And as I said, you can look up the Earth on Wikipedia and you find all these facts and figures. So we know the Earth is round. It's basically a sphere. Not quite a sphere. At the equator, it has a radius of about 6,378 kilometers, and it's slightly less, slightly oblate. So it's at the poles, it's slightly smaller. It's only 6 kilometers. And of course, nowadays, you know, we can actually measure this fairly directly. We have all these GPS satellites, and you can, you know, you can take a whole picture of the whole Earth like this. And we can measure this extremely precisely. But now let's, as a thought experiment, just subtract all this technology. Okay, suppose we don't have satellites, we don't have space flight. Let's say we don't even have air travel or even much ocean travel, or even telescopes or sextants. We don't much of anything. Basically, go back to the technology of ancient Greeks. Can you still compute the radius of the Earth, okay, without all that technology? Actually, even more basic question, can we even tell the Earth is round? I mean, it's so obvious once you have this picture, but not so obvious if we don't have that. Okay, so so the ancient Greeks actually were able to work this out, and pretty much, you know, they had almost zero technology, but they did have geometry. In fact, they pretty much invented modern geometry, and that's pretty much all you need, or plus some, or some measurements, but a lot less than you might think. So, for example, the very first basic question, you know, is the Earth round? So, you know, the Greeks thought about this, and many of the Greek philosophers gave sort of aesthetic arguments, you know, the sphere's most perfect shape or whatever. But the first really convincing scientific proof that the Earth was round was given by Aristotle back in 3rd century BC, 4th century BC. And it was an indirect argument because he could not look directly at all of the Earth at the same time, at least not the perspective to see it as round. So it's indirect. Every single measurement basically is indirect. And pretty much every time you want to measure an object in astronomy, you have to compare it with a different object. You have to somehow use a second celestial body. And so he used the moon. Okay, so he used the moon to show that the Earth was round. Okay, so how did he do this? So he knew about eclipses. Right? Every so often, the moon should be full, but sometimes during the full moon, the moon goes dark. It's a lunar eclipse. And it was observed already by the ancient Greeks that this only happens at certain times. It only happens at the time of full moon. And at the time of full moon, the moon is directly opposite the sun in the Earth. So the sun would be over here, and the moon's over here. If the moon and sun are at that angle other than 180 degrees, you don't get lunar eclipses. You only get lunar eclipses when the sun and the moon are opposed. And so Aristotle reasoned that the reason why this was happening was because the Earth casts a shadow. Okay, so the sun casts a shadow. So the light of the sun makes the Earth cast a shadow, and lunar eclipses happen precisely because the moon falls sometimes into the shadow of the Earth. And that only happens when the Earth and moon, sun and moon are opposed. Okay, but when an eclipse occurs, so sometimes you get a partial eclipse, and so the Earth's shadow is obscures part of the moon, and the shadow is always a circular arc. Okay, so whenever you see a partial lunar eclipse, the terminator between light and dark is always a circular arc. Okay? So what it means is that every shadow of the Earth is a circle. And there's only one shape, is that every shadow is a circle, it's a sphere. Okay, so, for example, there's a competing theory that the Earth is a disk, a flat disk, and that wouldn't happen. If you have a flat disk, the shadows are sometimes ellipses, they're not circles. Okay? Sphere is the only shape where all the shadows are circles. Okay, so that was Aristotle's argument. He used almost zero measurement. You can prove this. You don't need any telescopes. You just need good enough eyesight that you can see that the terminator is actually a circle. Okay, so the Earth was round. Now, it could be round and very small, or round and very big. But Aristotle also knew. So even in the times of the Greeks, they couldn't travel across big oceans, but they could travel along small oceans, okay, so the Mediterranean. So they could get as far as Egypt in particular. And they knew that in Egypt there were certain constellations, certain stars that were visible in Egypt that you couldn't see in Greece. Okay? And once you knew the Earth was a sphere, you could see why this was happening. Okay, it's because the Earth is curved, and so if you're in Egypt, you see a different portion of space than in Greece. And so what that means is that already the distance from Greece to Egypt must be some substantial portion of the fraction of the entire circumference of the Earth, so enough that you can see that the set of stars that you can see is slightly shorter. So the Earth is not sort of infinite sphere, really some finite sphere. But this idea, this argument, didn't really give a good way to measure the radius. It was bigger than the distance from Greece to Egypt, but to get a really more accurate measurement looked difficult by this method. But still, this was a convincing argument, a scientific argument that the Earth is round. So, very famously, the first person to actually compute the radius of the Earth properly, maybe a century or so later, was Eratosthenes. So he computed the radius of Earth at 40,000 stadia, which is an ancient Greek unit, which in modern terms, the radius of the Earth is 6,800 kilometers or 4,200 miles, which is a remarkably good estimate given basically zero technology, because it's within 8% of the truth. And astronomy, 8% is actually not bad. So again, it's an indirect argument. So you need another celestial body. In this case, it's the sun. Okay, so you look at the sun. Well, not directly at the sun, but you use the sun. Okay. So it's a famous story. Many of you already know it, but I'll tell it anyway. So Eratosthenes had read somewhere there's a town in Egypt called Syene, and Syene had this well, and this well had this special property that one day of the year, the summer solstice, the longest day of the year, June 21st, you could look down in the well. It's a deep well, and you can see the sun reflected directly overhead. You can see the sun overhead from the water all the way down below in the well. Eratosthenes said this was cool, so he was going to try this himself. He waited until June 21st, but he didn't live in Syene. Hang on, before I do this. Okay, so, because the other strand, so we now know the reason why this is true. It's because Syene just happens to lie on this thing called the Tropic of Cancer, and that it happens to be basically almost the only location on Earth where this happens, that on one day of the year, the sun actually is directly overhead. There's also the Tropic of Cancer, but they didn't know about that one yet. Capricorn, sorry. Okay, so Eratosthenes tried this. He waited, he waited until June 21st in the town where he lived, the city where he lived, which just happened to be Alexandria. And he waited June 21st. He looked at a well, and he did not see the sun reflected overhead. So at this point, most people would just say, "Well, that story was rubbish," and move on. But maybe Eratosthenes knew about Aristotle's work. He knew the Earth was round, and he figured out what was going on. He figured out that basically, where he was living in Alexandria, the sun was not quite overhead. So assuming the sun is very, very far away, okay, so this is an assumption you can make, the rays of the sun are parallel, but the Earth is curved, and so even if you have a direct right angle here, you don't have a right angle here. Okay, so he was a good scientist, so he said, maybe I can do something with this. So he actually measured the deviation from the vertical. So he actually had a measuring stick called gnomon, and using some Greek geometry, he could actually work out the angle that the sun was making at noon on June 21st. And in modern units, it's 7 degrees off of the vertical. Okay. All right. Now, he also knew how far it was from Alexandria to Syene. So, they both live on the Nile, and there were merchants going up and down, and the merchants had to figure out how many days it takes to get from A to B, and how many stadia they can cover in a day. So it's not known exactly how he got this number, but this is a number which you can measure by direct measurement. There are some sources that he essentially hired a graduate student to pace from Alexandria to Syene, but it's this is just a story. I don't know to what extent this is actually true, although it's believable. But anyway, he got this one direct measurement, and this is actually almost pretty much the only direct measurement I've ever used in this whole talk. He knew the distance between Syene and Alexandria, and he knew this angle, and he knew trigonometry, not in our modern language, but he knew Greek trigonometry was good enough, and this is enough information to work out the rays of the Earth. Okay. To use more accuracy. Assuming the sun is so far away that these two lines are parallel, okay, but we'll sort of retroactively work that out later. All right, so that's how you at least measure the Earth. Okay, so now we climb to the next one of the ladder, which is the Moon. Basic questions. Okay, what shape is the Moon? Now, this is actually not quite a stupid question. You think, obviously it's round. But it could be round and flat. It could be a big plate. Right? We all see the same face of the Moon. Maybe it is just painted on the sky or something. How large is the Moon and how far away is the Moon? Okay, and the ancient Greeks could also figure out these questions too with pretty good accuracy. So back to Aristotle, he showed that the Earth was round. He also argued that the Moon was round, that it wasn't a disk. Again, using shadows. You see actually shadows are pretty much an incredibly useful tool in astronomy. They really give all kinds of data. Of course, as we all know, the Moon has phases, just because the Sun only illuminates part of the Moon. Not the other part. And again, whenever you have a moon phase, like gibbous or waxing or whatever, there's this terminator, the division between light and dark. And it's always an ellipse or a straight line, because the half moon. But it's always an elliptical shape. And basically, the reason collect because the Earth moves a sphere, and the sun illuminates exactly half of the sphere, and depending on what angle that makes with the Earth, you will see an ellipse. Okay. And again, basically, the sphere is pretty much the only shape, the only natural shape, at least, which has this property, that the terminates are ellipses. Now, if the moon was a disk, in fact, there'd be no phases at all. The sun would always illuminate either all the disk or none of the disk. Maybe at different intensities, so it might be a bright disk or a dark disk, but you never get a terminator. Terminators come from the sphericity of the moon. Okay, so the moon was also a sphere. And the distance of the moon was, again, quite famously computed by Aristarchus a little bit later. But not directly. You cannot directly measure the distance from the Earth to the moon, not even a good graduate student. But you can measure the distance in terms of a distance that you can already understand, which was the radius of the Earth. So he computed the distance from the Earth to the moon as 60 Earth radii, which is actually an important guess. I mean, the moon actually varies. It's not quite circular, but it varies from between 57 and 63, so you know, take the average, it's exactly spot on. And the size of the moon, he argued, was about a third the size of the Earth, which is not too bad. It's 0.27, in truth. But you know, that's also reasonably accurate, especially by Greek standards. Okay. And we know the radius of the Earth from Earth's Eratosthenes, so you can combine them, and then you start, you now can do the size of the moon and the distance of the moon in other units. Okay. So how did Aristarchus do this? So once again, indirect measurement, you need another celestial body, and there's really only one available, use the sun. Okay. And again, use shadows. You always use shadows. Okay, so lunar eclipses again. Okay, so as we saw already, lunar eclipses happen because the Earth casts a shadow, and the moon sometimes falls into the shadow, and that causes a lunar eclipse. Now, you can actually, you know, watch a lunar eclipse, and it starts and stops. And the reason they are finite length because the shadow has a finite size. So if the Earth has a radius r, the diameter of it is 2r, and so the shadow should basically be 2r, assuming the sun is far enough away. Now this is not quite 2r. It's a thing between umbra and penumbra, which I'm going to talk about. But roughly speaking, the shadow is the size 2r. That's the width of the shadow. And lunar eclipses don't last forever. Sometimes they're short, sometimes they're long, but they're never longer than 3 hours. You actually watch the once and last of eclipses. It's never more than 3 hours. And so basically, it takes 3 hours for the moon to cross two Earth radii, to traverse two Earth radii. On the other hand, you also know how long it takes the moon to complete a complete orbit around the Earth. It's 1 month, strangely enough, 1 lunar month, 28 days. Okay, so that the Greeks also knew. Okay, so in 28 days, you make a full revolution around the circle whose distance, radius is the distance to the moon. And in 3 hours, you traverse two Earth radii. And that's a nice, that's a math problem. That's enough information to work out the relationship between the radius of the Earth and the distance to the moon. Okay? And you get the distance to the moon is 60 Earth radii. Okay, so that's the distance to the moon. Now, how about the size of the moon? How do you know how much size of the moon is? Now, they didn't have sextants or even protractors, but you can just watch the moon set. Okay, the moon sometimes sets, it's a full moon setting. It takes about 2 minutes for a moon to set. And of course, the diameter of the moon is 2 moon radii. So the apparent motion of the moon traverses 2 moon radii in 2 minutes. Okay. But on the other hand, the moon goes around the Earth once every 24 hours, basically, pretty much. Well, of course, really, you know, the Earth is spinning, the apparent motion, the moon takes 24 hours to go around the Earth. So it traverses the entire circumference of its orbit in 24 hours, and it traverses 2 moon radii in 2 minutes. And again, that's a simple word problem. That's enough information to determine the radius of the moon in terms of the distance of the moon. And we had already computed the distance of the moon in terms of the radius of the Earth, so you put them together and you find that the radius of the moon is about 1/3 the radius of the Earth. Okay. So that was pretty impressive. Given pretty much zero technology and just a little bit of trigonometry, it can do all these things pretty accurately. And by the way, so even not only did they have zero technology, they also have very primitive mathematics by modern standards. So, for instance, they didn't quite have accuracy of pi yet. That was approximately 3. The first good approximation of pi was Archimedes, which was like several decades after Aristarchus. So, just the level of technology and mathematics, had was only just barely sufficient to answer this question, but it was able to do it. Okay, so that's the moon. Okay, so now we keep going up the ladder, and so the next natural object to understand is the sun. Okay, so again, the questions are, how big is the sun and how far away is the sun? The ancient Greeks also answered this question, but at this point, actually, the lack of technology started to hurt quite badly, but they were still able to get some answers. Now, indirect measurement, you need another object, only one object available, take the moon. Okay, actually, you know, it's interesting to speculate how much astronomy would be hindered if we didn't actually have a moon, but anyway. Okay, so Aristarchus already computed the distance to the moon, 60 Earth radii, and the radius of the moon, one-third of an Earth radius. So he knew that the radius of the moon was 1/180th of the distance to the moon. Okay, so he knew that already. And then, for the sun, so we use shadows again, but now we use solar eclipses. Okay, so there's this amazing coincidence that sometimes happens in astronomy, that solar eclipses happen when the moon obscures the Earth, and it happens that the moon and the Earth happen to almost exactly the same angle of it. Don't know why, it just happens sometimes you get the coincidences like this. So they had the same angular width, and they knew similar triangles, which invented the concept, the Greeks. So he deduced therefore that since the radius of the moon was 1/180th the distance to the moon, therefore the radius of the sun was 1/180th the distance to the sun. Okay? So if you know the distance to the sun, you can also compute the radius of the sun. Okay? But you still need to compute one of these two separately. Okay, so let's compute the distance to the sun. Okay, so we have to do it indirectly, you need another object, okay, use the moon. Okay, so we use phases again, we're always using shadows. Moon has phases. They have new moon, full moon, half moon, and so forth. Okay, so when do new moons occur? Okay, new moons occur when the moon is directly between the Earth and the sun, right? Full moons occur when the Earth moon is directly opposite the sun from the Earth. We saw already. Okay, so half moons, so it's something you get half moons when exactly half of the moon is lit. So you think maybe half moons occur exactly halfway between new moons and full moons. But they don't. If you actually do the trigonometry, or just take a look at the picture, the reason you get a half moon is because there's a right angle over here, okay, that the line from the Earth to the moon makes a right angle from the Earth to the sun. So right angle here, not here, but here. When you have a right angle on this side of the triangle, then exactly half of the moon will be visible to the Earth. Okay? So what you see, therefore, is that half moons are just a little bit closer to new moons than they are to full moons. Okay? So if you can actually measure how much closer, that gives you data. Okay. So Aristarchus tried to compute this, and it wasn't easy with the technology that they had. But he asserted, I'm not sure how he got this number, but he asserted that half moons occur a little bit sooner than the midpoint of a new moon and a full moon. And he asserted they occur 12 hours sooner. Now, this is not actually true. But if you take for granted that number, given that the moon takes 28 days to make a full revolution, you can compute this angle, the triangle, and then by some trigonometry, you can work out the ratio between the distance to the moon and the distance to the sun. And so using that computation and the best value of pi that he had, is there any easy way to do this? I guess I'll accept it. So using this 12-hour data point, he was able to compute that the distance to the sun was about 20 times the distance to the moon. Now, this is not quite true. So actually, the main problem here was that Greek timekeeping technology was pretty bad. You want accurate time. You also need accurate telescopes, which we also didn't have, to measure when a new moon occurred. But at the time of a half moon, the most accurate clocks they had were sundials, which didn't work at night for some reason. There was actually a certain problem with the measurement. The discrepancy between half moon and halfway between new moon and full moon is not 12 hours, definitely half an hour. The distance to the sun actually is not 20 times the distance to the moon, it is 290 times distance. So they are up by quite a bit because now of limitations in technology. But the method is correct. So you know, if they had more technology, the method would have worked more accurately. And even with the imperfect conclusion data that they had, Aristarchus still created, so he had all the information. He knew the distance to the moon in terms of Earth radii, he knew the distance to the sun in terms of distance to the moon, and he knew the radius of the sun in terms of distance to the sun. So you put all that together, and he was the first person to realize something very important. The sun is bigger than the Earth. Okay. You put all this together, he computed the sun was 7 Earth radii. Now, at the time, this is sort of obvious nowadays, but it was not obvious, the sun is about this big, right? Okay. The Earth is this big. Okay. It is not obvious that the sun is bigger than the Earth. Now, this was an incorrect measurement because the data was wrong. If you plug in the correct data, the sun is actually 109 times the radius of the Earth. But still, the basic conclusion is correct. The sun is much, much bigger than the Earth. And so, of course, at the time the dominant cosmological theory was the geocentric theory, that the sun was going around the Earth, but now he realized the sun is 7 times as big as the Earth, so that this cannot possibly be correct. And Aristarchus was the first that we know of to actually propose the heliocentric model. But actually, he proposed that the Earth goes around the sun, because the sun is a bigger body. Okay. And if he knew the sun was this much bigger than the Earth, he would definitely have done so. Now, you may think, wait a minute, that's not what I learned in school. It was Copernicus, wasn't it, who proposed the model? He did too, 1700 years later. And in the first page of Copernicus, I think of Dialogue, or whatever the name of his work was, he credited Aristarchus for the concept. Now, one reason why we don't know about his work as well is because the other ancient Greeks disputed his conclusion. And there's a good reason for that, and I'll come back to that later. Okay, but anyway, so Aristarchus was able to compute a very important unit in astronomy, the distance from the Earth to the Sun. And so this unit is so fundamental, we give it the name of the astronomical unit, AU. And pretty much every later step of the ladder for quite a while, it was measured in terms of this AU. Okay, so much of the planets and the other stars, so if you try to measure their distance in terms of the AU. This turns out to be an extremely crucial point in the ladder. And so it was actually a serious problem that Aristarchus had a really lousy estimate of the AU, but people did work out better ways to compute it much later on. Okay, so that's the Earth and the Moon and the Sun. The next one is the planets. Okay, so the ancient Greeks also studied the planets. They knew that that the planets all lie on a plane because they only went through a certain ring of constellations, what we now know as the zodiac, Cancer, Libra, Virgo, and so forth. So they all lie on a plane, and it's called the ecliptic. But in this plane, what happens? Okay, so again, basic questions, how far away are the planets? Like, how far away is Mars? What are their orbits? What do they actually do? And how long does it take for, say, Mars to go around its orbit? Okay, so since it's so obvious that the Moon takes 28 days, but Mars is less clear. Okay, so this was again attempted by the Greeks. So Ptolemy was the first, I think Hipparchus also tried it. But Ptolemy was the first to seriously attempt these questions. But he created, his answers were really, really inaccurate, much worse than Aristarchus. Basically, he was using the wrong model. He was trying to do this using the geocentric model, and very hard to fit the data with the geocentric model. So he had to invent those epicycles to even get so close. The Greeks actually did not succeed in any reasonable sense. The first person to actually compute the distances to the planets properly was Copernicus, who basically framed the heliocentric model as a consequence. So Copernicus did have access to the records of the ancient Babylonians. So they measured the position of the wandering planets, the wandering stars, the planets for centuries. Mars does do a funny thing, right? It goes backwards and forwards and so forth, but it turns out that every 780 days, the position of Mars in the sky returns to where it starts. Okay, so the apparent period, or so the synodic period of Mars is 780 days. Now, under the geocentric model, this means that Mars takes 780 days to go around the Earth. But Copernicus was working with the heliocentric model, and he knew that he was proposing that the Earth was going around the Sun, and Mars was also going around the Sun. And so 780 days is not the rotational, one rotation for 780 days is not the angular velocity of Mars, it's actually the angular velocity of Mars minus the angular velocity of Earth, or vice versa. Under the heliocentric model, you knew that the Earth would take a year to go around the Sun, because you could see the seasons and the changing constellations and so forth. So he knew that Earth took 1 year to go around the Sun, and so the angular velocity of Earth was one rotation per year, and he implied that the differential between the angular velocity of Mars and angular velocity of Earth was once every 70 days, and so he was able to work out the true period of Mars, the sidereal period. So Mars actually went around the Sun once every 687 days, so subtracting the two velocities. So he knew that Mars went around the Sun while he's in his heliocentric model, and he knew how often, 687 days. Okay, and then he started, at this point he assumed circular orbits. So he assumed that that Mars went around in a perfect circle, and Earth went around in a perfect circle, and the only unknown lattice is the relative ratio between the radius of the Earth orbit and the Mars orbit, and he had enough mathematics at the time to compute, to then solve for that radius using various astronomical data. Yeah, so at any given time, you can see where the Sun is rising. Maybe it's rising in Libra, and the Mars is maybe it's in Capricorn. Okay, and so this gives you some information about the directions that Mars and the Sun make respect to Earth, and that plus trigonometry is enough to work out where Mars is, assuming circular orbits. And he computed that the distance from Mars to the Sun is about 1.5 astronomical units. That Mars is about 50% further away from the Sun than the Earth. Okay. So this is already a somewhat serious calculation. This is not so obvious, but this is it. And the calculations that he did are quite accurate to two decimal places. Okay, so a little bit later, Tycho Brahe, astronomer, made very detailed measurements over many years of the position of all the planets that they knew about, including Mars, when they rose, when they set, what constellation they were in, and so forth. In fact, he basically got this enormous government grant from the King of Denmark. They basically governed an entire island, complete with a village of peasants to build an astronomer, a tower. I've actually seen the tower, it's actually quite important. When he tried to fit this data that he had, okay, so the type of data he had, for his time, and then for every point in data, there's some declination of where Mars is compared to what angle in the sky Mars makes with respect to some fixed direction in the sky. But you try to fit this to the Copernican model of circular orbits, and it doesn't quite work. It's about 10% off. Okay. The measurements were accurate enough that you could actually see this discrepancy. It wasn't a measurement error. It was actually a model error. And so Kepler managed to get his hands on the data. Actually, there's some story. I think he basically stole the data. I think he asked Brahe for it and refused. Okay. But anyway, but somehow he got his hand on the data. And he reasoned that what was going on was that the orbits of the Earth and Mars were not quite circles. This was the only reason why